I welcome you again to the next in the ongoing lecture series on women's intimate health by Dr. Ragini Agrawal and Indian Academy of Cosmetic Dermatology and Gynecology. This webinar is organized in association with Bhiwani Obstetric Gynae Society. On behalf of Jaxonpal Pharmaceuticals Limited, makers of Jepidone Syrup, Cyclorex CR10 and Endorec Tablet, I'm Dr. Vipin Tyagi along with my teammates Dr. Deepika Chavda and Mr. Amit Saxena. For today's discussion on revisiting menstruation, mystery and misery, we welcome the convener and moderators, Dr. Ragini Agrawal, National Vice President FOCSI, President IACDG, and Founder Chair Aesthetic Health Committee of IMS, Dr. Chandan Kachru, Chairperson Udan Project, Harobgain, and Consultant W. Pratiksha Hospital, Gurugram. We are thankful to ICOG for the accreditation of one ICOG point to all attendees of the webinar today. We welcome all attendees. Please post your queries by text in the Q&A box to be answered at the end. Please note, this webinar is brought to you as knowledge sharing initiative by Jaxonpal Medical Services, and this session is streaming on Facebook Live. The recording will remain on Jaxonpal's YouTube channel for reference and promotion. I will now request Dr. Chandan Kachru ma'am to kindly initiate the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Vipin. Thanks, Jaxonpal. A very good evening to all of you. Thanks for joining us for these 3 days of Dr. Ragini Agarwal's pre-Navaratri Academic Festival. I welcome you on behalf of Dr. Ragini Agarwal and IACDG with Bhiwani Obstetrics and Gynae Society to this another leaf in the ongoing series of women's intimate health. Today's topic is revisiting menstruation, mystery and misery. To start with, let us welcome our chief guest for today's webinar, Dr. Nandita Palshetkar. I think she needs no introduction. She is a recipient of many accolades and awards, and she's epitome of excellence in women's health. Be it in fertility, gynecology, or women's community health, she has done tremendous work in the field of women's health. She's past President FOCSI, President AMOG's Vice President ESAR 2020. She's past president of many, many organizations. I welcome you, ma'am. Kindly bless us with your kind words. Dr. Nandita, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Chandan, for that nice introduction. At the onset, I would like to thank my friend Ragini for inviting me here as the chief guest. I think Ragini and me go back for 2 to 3 decades, literally. That's when we met first, and we've remained friends since then. And I've seen the exponential rise in Ragini's career. So I'm really happy today that your Indian Academy of Dermatology and Gynecology is doing so well. And today's topic that you've taken, Ragini, menstruation, mysteries and miseries. I would like to just, I love the word mystery, and I think we as IVF specialists have really contributed a lot to the changing scenario in menstruation. Like there was this beautiful article by Bearworld and Pearson. They are the people who first put out this thought process that there are multiple waves of anterior follicular development in one cycle. So, you know, the whole concept of follicular phase, there's anterior waves, and then they all go undergo atresia. It's not like that. There are minimum 2 cycles in all patients and 3 in nearly 30% more people. So 3 waves of follicular. So the whole ovarian physiology has changed. Then Dorstev and Diamond have said, you know, that estrogen is not responsible for the ovulation trigger. It's LH-independent progesterone. So the whole concepts are changing, and I think the treatments also will change as we go by. And I'm really excited about this field because so many new things are coming in. And, you know, the Nobel Prize this year was given to Charpentier and Donaudy, who are the people who did gene editing. So I think we are definitely there on the scene, and lots of new things coming. So I'm really happy that today y'all are touching on this topic. And I'm waiting to hear Alka ji, Prateek, Dr. Lakshmi Shrikhande is my co-chief guest, so let's see what she says, and Bharti and Kavita. It'll be wonderful listening to all of y'all, and hopefully a lot of, doubts which are in the mind of a lot of people will be cleared, because right now we are doing telemedicine, and I think menstrual problems. Today morning, two patients called up with irregular periods premenstrually, premenopausally. You know, it's very difficult breaking on to these 40, 41, 42 year old that, sorry, you're premenopausal. But that is something we have to learn to educate these girls and guide them as they enter gracefully into menopause. So thank you, Ragini, for inviting me. And I think you're going to have a wonderful session with all these people. And Lakshmi, I think three decades, again, I know Lakshmi also, and I've seen her doing fantastic work, and she's coming on as ICOG, so I'm sure we'll see her shine over there. So thank you, Ragini. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nandita.
Thank you, ma'am.
And literally the angle you have given to the menstruation, it's very new, and people has to think in that way also. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Nandita, for your very inspiring words. Next, I would like to invite Dr. Lakshmi Shrikhande. She's our guest of honor for today's webinar from Nagpur. Most of us know her, know that she's a very, very excellent academician from Nagpur. And ma'am, I am personally become a fan of yours. From adolescence to menopause, you seem to have achieved what I call the ultimate nectar of knowledge. Your academic brilliance is beyond compare. Dr. Lakshmi is Medical Director, Shrikhande Fertility Clinic at Nagpur, Chairperson Designate ICOG. She has been President of many societies in Nagpur and Vidarbha. I welcome you, ma'am. Please say a few words for us. Dr. Lakshmi, please.
Thank you, Chandan. Today's chief guest, Dr. Nandita Palshetkar, conveners Vandana Punia, Anita Panwar, moderators Ragini and Chandan, and all the esteemed panelists Bharti, Alkaji, Pratik, and Kavita. Today's webinar is a really very special webinar, because on an average, a woman spends 40 years of her life with the menstruation. And most of the times, this menstruation turns into misery for her. If it is not coming, she is miserable. If she is frequently coming, it is scanty periods. If it is bleeding heavily. So many times for these miseries, she has to go to the gynecologist. And for the gynecologist, the mystery starts. This is a mystery whether what she is saying, that this is a heavy bleeding, is it really heavy, or it is the perception of the lady that she is having heavy bleeding? What complaint she is having, is it really affecting her so much? How I can treat her? How to treat her up to her satisfaction? So all these mysteries, the gynecologist starts wondering how she can be of help to this particular lady. So kudos to Dr. Ragini and the entire team for having a focused discussion on the menstruation, miseries and menstruation. And as Dr. Nandita has rightly said, it has been really changed what we learned during our undergraduate and postgraduate days. And now what we are teaching to our postgraduates. So everything has changed right from physiology to the treatment. And as a core ART person, Nandita, I am there as a core ART person. Now we can't say that you are 40 plus and you are postmenopausal or you are having a premature ovarian failure, because they sit in our OPD to have a child. So the whole gambit of menstruation right from menarche to menopause has totally changed. So once again, thanks Ragini for inviting me here for this webinar. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lakshmi.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Thank you so much. And literally, I think we will have another part of the menstruation which will focus on this new way of the ART addressing the menstruation.
Yes. You've given us another topic.
Physiology.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. To take it further, I would welcome my co-conveners, Dr. Vandana Punia, President Vivani Obstetrics and Gynae Society and Director Vandana Heart and Maternity Center, Bhiwani, and Dr. Anita Panwar, Secretary Bhiwani Obstetrics Gynae Society and Director Panwar Nursing Home Bhiwani. I request Dr. Anita to introduce Dr. Ragini to take this session forward. Dr. Anita, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of Bhiwani Obs and Gynae Society, I welcome Dr. Ragini Agarwal, ma'am. She is a dynamic national vice president of FOCSI and president of her OBGYN. She is a president of IACGD, founder and chair Aesthetic Health Committee, IMS. I welcome you, ma'am, and I invite Dr. Ragini, ma'am, for next session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. Thank you, Nandita, and thank you, Lakshmi, for giving a very good introduction to the topic. I say aurat ka to dusra naam menstruation hai. The day she reached the menarche, the mystery and misery of menstruation starts. When it is going to come, whether it is going to be regular or irregular, causing a pain or too heavy bleeding, scanty bleeding, everything is a problem to the girl, to the family, and the way she is going forward, it will start one and another problem. Not only this, the next thing is the so many taboos, so many things surrounding the menstruation. It is very, very difficult. So women have experienced periods before we fully evolved as a species. If you see, there's a very little documentation about the woman's period in the ancient history. Probably the problem of the woman is never taken very seriously at that time. And one thing is very special about the woman menstruation, that is, it is an overt menstruation, which is not even found most of the primates also, only the chimpanzee and for few simians monkeys have this thing, and only three other species, elephant and four species of the bats and the spiny mouses has a overt menstruation. Now, what is overt menstruation? What is special about this overt menstruation? Why the only Homo sapiens females have this menstruation? So this is a spontaneous desterilization in the human females, and it gives a maternal control on the maternal fetal conflict to increase selectivity over the implanted embryo, what our Nandita and the Lakshmi is talking. And this may be necessary in the human due to the abnormally large number of the genetic disorder in the Homo sapiens. And since most of the aneuploidy events result in the stillbirth or miscarriage, there is an evolutionary advantage to ending the pregnancy early and rather than nurturing a fetus that will later miscarry. So from here only the Homo sapiens female are special to have a special type of the menstruation. Every month their uterus is primed to receive an embryo which is not in other animals. So it is evidence to show that some abnormalities in the developing embryo can be detected by the cells in the uterus also. And this triggers epigenetic changes that prevent formation of the placenta, leaving the fetus to die and be removed in the next menstruation. So what we say that the uterus, which is prepared to receive a baby, doesn't receive a baby, then it weeps and the tear of blood comes out as a menstruation. The menstruation, the female is surrounded by so many myths. Historians believe that menstruating women is associated with magic and sorcery. Even the Roman author and philosopher wrote that the menstruating women could stop hail storms and the lightning. No one knows for sure that women used when they have period. Now there's a literally and suddenly in last few years, everybody is talking about the menstruation. It has become a movement. When a woman is having a menstruation so many years, nobody is talking about anything. The women are suffering silently. They don't have a proper sanitary pads or anything. But suddenly we are talking about so many movements of the menstrual hygiene. On the ancient Egyptian, there's a tampon made of the softened papyrus. Greeks have tampons from the bits of wood. And the Roman used pads and the made of the wool. Even Historians generally conclude that most women used rags or other absorbent materials, or they just free bleed into their clothes. And till today, when this menstrual movement has come in the light, we came to know there's so many in the poorer part and the uneducated part and the backward part, women still bleeds in the sand, lying in the court, and they are shunned out of the house. And there was a lot of religious shame surrounding periods, so women went to the insane lengths to hide their cycle from the public. In Victorian era in the 1900, yes, it was started coming with the pads, and the first pad came in the 1890s as a hosier sentry belt, which is very, very painful. And in 1888, the first disposable pad came in the market. And there's a wood pulp bandage which was used in the hospital, was used as a pad. Then the first tampon in come in the 1929. And in 1970, the first self-adhesive pad come in the market, which can attach to the underwear directly. So this is a mystery of menstruation, why it is happening, how much is normal, how much is not normal, what should be duration, how much, complaints if woman is saying, then we consider it is within the limit. And suddenly, by 2015, everybody is talking about the menstrual hygiene. We are having a menstrual hygiene day. We are talking about that menstruation matter. People online are marking the second annual menstrual hygiene day awareness in this particular slide. So that some few facts, when we talk about the menstrual cycle, anything between 21 days to 35 days are normal. Average volume can be anything between the 10 to 80 ml, as Lakshmi has said. When they are coming with a scanty period, say really they are having a scanty period, where they are saying they are having a heavy period, really they are having a heavy period. It is again a food of thought. Duration 2 to 7 days, mild symptoms. Up to 80% have some or other symptoms, but PMS only comes into 20 to 30% women, and severe symptoms in 3 to 8% women. Then there is a different type of the products. There are the disposable products. We all know that tampons, sanitary pads, and the disposable menstrual cup. But today, our focus is more on the reusable products like menstrual cups. It's very hygienic and very affordable, economical, reusable cloth pads, because many women has a rashes and recurrent vaginitis because of these pads. Then padded panties are in the market, and blanket towels also to be used if they are having very. Then I came across something like tampon tax. It used to be applicable in the Britain for the women who dispose those tampon. So there's another term, is a period poverty. It is a global issue affecting women and girls who do not have access to the safe and hygienic sanitary products. Most of the region have menstrual related tradition, and the quality of the menstrual education in a society determines the accuracy of the people's understanding of the process. So what we have to do, the effective education programs are essential to provide children and adolescents with clear and accurate information about menstruation. The schools can be appropriate place for menstrual education to take place. Low-income girls are less likely to receive proper sex education on puberty, leading to a decreased understanding of why menstruation occurs. This has been shown to cause the development of a negative attitude towards menstruation in the society. An effect of the culture on the menstruation is about culture aspects surrounding how society views the menstruation. We all know we have grown up with the lots of taboos. Yahan nahi baitho, wahan nahi baitho, ye nahi karo, wo nahi karo. If you touch the pickles, it will go wrong. So many taboos. And in some society involves menstruation being perceived as unclean or embarrassing, inhibiting even in the mention of the menstruation, whether in the public or in private. And mostly religions consider menstruation ritual unclean. Only in Buddhism and Sikhism, they take it as a regular, normal physiological process, and there's nothing to shame it and nothing unclean related to the menstruation. In India, even mere mention of the topic has been a taboo in the past. Even to this date, the culture and the social influences appear to be hurdle for advancement of the knowledge on the subject in the most of the part. So another thing, the terminology. So many terminology when we are the PG student, metro, mino metro regia, minoregia, metroregia, hyperminoria, polyminoria, polyminoregia. It's very, very difficult. And this one term, metropathica hemorrhagica, I still remember, Swiss cheese appearance. So dysfunctional bleeding. But now it was all streamlined. And FIGO has come with a AUB system. One, first the DUB has converted into AUB. Frequency, regularity, duration, volume, and accordingly you have to change your and write down your prescription from which the woman is suffering. And we all know our palm and coin system. I'm not going to go in detail because the speakers are going to focus on that in their speak. So the things are changed, the menstruation to its terminology. And today chief of guest and the guest of honor, both core ART specialists, have given his new insight also related to the ART. But we are going to focus most of the misery with the woman is suffering, whether it is a scanty period, no period, heavy period, painful period, or period when you attain the menopause. So I will, before introducing my esteemed faculty, I will end this talk with a woman complain about PMS, but I think of it as the only time of the month when I can be myself. Shoo. So coming to my faculty, amenorrhea will be talked about by none other than our MTP committee FOXI chairperson, Professor Bharti Maheshwari from Mujaffarpur Medical College. Heavy menstrual bleeding by Alka ji. Alka ji has vice president elect from the East Zone. Then we have dysmenorrhea, the endocrine committee chairperson, Dr. Pratik Kambe from Mumbai. And ever smiling, with a naughty, naughty smile, a very knowledgeable Dr. Kavita Bapat, who will take over next year with Dr. Shanta Kumari as a West Zone Vice President for postmenopausal bleeding. With this, I will hand over to Chandan again to take over the proceedings.
My internet is not working.
So, Dr. Just to say, Dr. Bharti Maheshwari, very, very jovial person, and we spent one night together in Mahabaleshwar. At that time, we have spent many time with Dr. Bharti Maheshwari and came to know she's such a down-to-earth person. Even she has so many laurel in front of her. She is the professor and the head of department of Mujaffarnagar Medical College, diploma in IVF and reproductive medicine Germany, chairperson FOXI MTP committee, fellowship in medical education by MCI. She was governing council member elect ICOG also. And she has organized many, many conferences as organizing secretary. Over to, and also not only she has delivered Komni Rao oration also. Over to you, Bharti, for your talk.
Thank you, Dr. Ragni, and thank you very much. So first of all, I would like to congratulate and really appreciate the topic and theme what Dr. Ragni has chosen, that is a menstrual mystery. And really, this is a very important topic. And as I know, Dr. Ragni, we met in for last 2-3 years, discussed lots of things. And what I felt and observed that Dr. Ragni always, she do something innovative, original thinking. And she is bold enough to organize what she wants, and her all topics are really unique and useful. So thank you, Dr. Ragni, especially giving me this opportunity to involve me in your webinar. Thank you. And our chief guest, Dr. Nandita Pashekar, guest of honor, Dr. Lakshmi, and all speakers, Dr. Kavita, Dr. Pratik, and organizers, Dr. Chandan, and Dr. Vivani President Madam, so Dr. Alka Pandey Madam, so thank you, and really it's an opportunity to participate in this webinar with you all. So now, without wasting even a single minute, I just coming to my topic, and that what Dr. Ragni has given me very important topic, and that is the amenorrhea. So we all know that the amenorrhea, it is a important topic because the menstrual, this is the our first topic when we do practice in the gynae, or when we learn something in the gynae, the menstrual cycles and related issues, that is the priority. So regarding amenorrhea, we all know that could be primary amenorrhea or secondary amenorrhea. Primary amenorrhea, if we talk by the definition, absence of menses by age 14 year with no development of secondary sexual characteristic, or by age 16 year with normal development of secondary sexual characteristic. By secondary amenorrhea, we all know that the cessation of menses either at least 6 months or at least three of previous three cycles interval. And if you have a look on the events of the puberty, you can think that it is started from the thalarchy with a breast development, which requires hormone estrogen, followed by pubarchy, adenarchy, when the pubic hair development is there, which require androgens, and then it comes menarche, which requires GnRH from the hypothalamus, FSH and LH from the pituitary, estrogen and progesterone from the ovaries and normal outflow tract. So control of menstrual cycles, we all know it, it is from hypothalamus, pituitary, endocrine, ovarian and outflow tract axis. And the etiology of amenorrhea is that with any hindrance and any pathology at any level that can cause amenorrhea. Like in the hypothalamus, if there is a, it could be hypothalamic hypogonadism or weight-related amenorrhea. At the level of pituitary, could due to pituitary adenoma or Sheehan syndrome. At the endocrine, it could be the hypothyroidism. At the ovarian level, by dysgenesis, gonadal failure or PCOS, and at the outflow tract axis, congenital absence of uterus, vagina, atresia, hypophoric hymen, and Ashraman syndrome. So if you talk about the magnitude of the problem, so secondary amenorrhea, it is the more common, its prevalence is about 3%, and primary amenorrhea, it is 0.3%. So between 10 to 20% of women complaining of infertility, they have amenorrhea. And it's the fact that up to 50% of competitive runners or athletes, or and even up to 40%, 44% of ballet dancers, they have amenorrhea. So if you talk about the amenorrhea, primary amenorrhea etiology, then we can divide it with the secondary sexual characteristic presents and without. If with the secondary sexual characteristic presents, we have regions like the constitutional delay, genitourinary malformations, androgen insensitivity, resistant ovarian syndrome in pregnancy. And the causes where the secondary sexual characteristics are absent, then it could be hypothalamic dysfunctions, especially chronic illness, anorexia, weight loss, stress, gonadotropin deficiencies like Kallmann syndromes, hypopituitarism, hyperprolactinemia, hypothyroidism, and gonadal failure, ovarian dysgenesis, agenesis, premature ovarian failure. Besides that, primary amenorrhea is also in the ambiguous external genitalia, like congenital adrenal hyperplasia, androgen secreting tumors, and 5-alpha reductase deficiency. You can see there's a congenital adrenal hyperplasia, Sertoli leading cells tumors, where this is a hyperandrogenism, Turner syndrome, so it is caused by either a complete absence or a partial abnormality of one of the two X chromosomes. About 50% have mosaic forms, such as 45X or 46X, and you all know that is the typical features Turner syndrome. Short stature, web neck, lymphedema, shield chest, widely spaced nipple, wide carrying angle, coarctation of aorta, and streak ovaries. Then comes to the other important cause of primary amenorrhea, that is the uterovaginal agenesis. It constitutes 15% of primary amenorrhea. Normal secondary sexual development, normal female range testosterone level, but absent uterus and upper vagina and normal ovary. Karyotyping, there is a 46X and 15 to 30% they have associated renal, skeletal and middle ear abnormality. So this is a picture where you can say that you absent uterus. And androgen insensitivity syndrome. This is also known as the testicular feminization in the past. It is a 46XY chromosome, and there is a failure of normal masculinization of the external genitalia in chromosomically male individuals. So this failure of virilization can be either complete or partial, and affected individuals have normal testes with normal production of testosterone and normal conversion to the DHT. And what this is the factor that which differentiated with the 5-alpha reductase deficiency. So this is the picture that is present like this. Imperforate hymen, we all are familiar with this condition where it represents the most common and most distal form of vaginal outflow obstruction. And we all know that most of the time, sometimes it is incidentally diagnosed, and sometimes patients come with the primary amenorrhea with abdominal or back pain. The differential diagnosis of UV obstructions include disorders of vaginal development, such as septum or complete vaginal agenesis. You can see that the imperforate hymen. Constitutional delay. In this condition, there is no anatomical abnormality and endocrine investigations show normal results caused by immature pulsatile release of gonadotropin-releasing hormone. Maturation eventually occurs spontaneously. So how we have to approach these cases of primary amenorrhea? So assessment is very simple. We have to, as I have categorized, if puberty is delayed, secondary sexual characters are not present, then you have to go first for the TSH. If it is elevated, then you have to manage accordingly. And simultaneously, you have to calculate the bone age also. If it is delayed, then the constitutional delay could be the reason. And if bone age is normal, then LHFS session for actin level, you have to focus on that. If they are low, then you can go for the MRI and can find out the C for the pituitary tumor or the brain lesions. And if these levels are normal or if these are elevated, then you have to go for the karyotyping. And if it is 45XO, the cause is gonadal dysgenesis. And if it is a normal 46XO, then the primary cause is ovarian failure. And if puberty is not delayed, secondary sexual characters are present, then go for the TSH and prolactin. If it is elevated, then manage accordingly. If they are normal, then go for the progestin challenge test. If it is negative, go for the estrogen progestin challenge test. If again it is negative, then most probably outlet obstruction. And if it is positive, then go for the FSH and LH level. And they are low, then again a head MRI to find out any chronic disease, anorexia or psychological stress. And if it is high, then do the karyotyping. And it could be normal, then cause is ovarian failure, otherwise could be Turner syndrome. And if it is the progestin challenge test is positive, then of course an ovulatory cycle or reason could be PCO and all, and you can manage properly. Third thing, the primary amenorrhea could be genital tract abnormalities. Here, if you find out this, then you have to do the karyotyping. If it is 46XY, you go for the testosterone level. If it is in the male range, then it is most likely androgen insensitivity. And if it is in the female range, then testicular regression or gonadal enzyme deficiency. If karyotype is 46XX, then you have to go for the Mullerian agenesis, and you have to manage accordingly. You remember that breast development, pubertal growth spurt, and adrenarche, if they are delayed or absent in person with, then most likely it is the hypothalamic pituitary failure. Adrenarche occur normally, while estrogen-dependent breast development and the pubertal growth spurt, they are absent or delayed, means isolated ovarian insufficiency or failure. And then comes to the secondary amenorrhea. We all know that here we can again categorize with the hyperandrogenism or without hyperandrogenism. If there is no hyperandrogenism, then it could be physiologic like pregnancy, lactation, menopause, iatrogenic, again DIMPA or contraceptive injections, radiotherapy, chemotherapy, systemic disease, chronic illness, hypo or hyperthyroidism. Uterine causes could be cervical stenosis, Asherman syndrome. Ovarian causes, premature ovarian failure, resistant ovarian syndrome, hypothalamic causes, weight loss, exercise, psychological, pituitary causes, hyperprolactinemia, hypopituitarism, and Sheehan syndrome. And if lady is showing the androgen axis, then it could be PCOS, Cushing syndrome, late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia, adrenal or ovarian androgen producing tumor. PCOD, this is a whole topic we all know that we have done through many times, that could have a features of falsetism, amenorrhea, and ultrasound can make the diagnosis, and it is associated with endocrine abnormalities. And Asherman syndromes, we all know that it is an iatrogenic cause of amenorrhea. Premature ovarian failure, when menopause or ovarian failure occur before the age of 40 years, it's considered premature. It is autoimmune disease, mostly the autoantibodies to ovarian cell, gonadotropin receptors, and oocyte. They have been reported in 80% of cases. This is the most important case. Before puberty or in adolescence, ovarian failure is usually due to a chromosomal abnormalities like Turner mosaic or previous radiotherapy or chemotherapy. So once you think that is the ovarian failure, premature menopause, could be chromosomal anomalies. If the woman is under 30, you should go for the karyotyping to rule out any mosaicism involving a Y chromosome. If a Y chromosome is found, the gonad should be surgically excised. And if it is an autoimmune disease, it is necessary to screen for thyroid, parathyroid, and adrenal dysfunction. autoimmune related dysfunction, the most common association is with thyroid disease and parathyroid and adrenal. Several studies have shown the laboratory evidence of immune problems in about 15 to 40% of women with premature ovarian failure. But in general, ovarian biopsy is not indicated in a patient with premature ovarian failure as a first line thing, since clinically useful since there is no additional clinical useful information will be obtained. Hyperprolactinemia, prolactinoma, it is the commonest cause of hyperprolactinemia in 60% of cases, and in other cases could be non-functional pituitary adenoma. Dopaminergic antagonist drugs, we all know antiepileptic, primary hypothyroidism, or it may be idiopathic. Prolactin acts directly on the hypothalamus to reduce the amplitude and frequency of pulses of GnRH hormone. Weight-related amenorrhea, it is also important cause of secondary amenorrhea. Regular menstrual cycles is unlikely to occur if body mass index is less than 19. Weight loss may be due to illness, anorexia, and among which anorexia nervosa lies is the extreme end of the spectrum. Progesterone-associated amenorrhea is important cause of secondary amenorrhea, where DIMPA inhibits the secretion of gonadotropins and thus suppresses the ovulation. After 1 year of use of DIMPA injection, 80% of women have amenorrhea or very scanty infrequent vagina bleeding. There is a partial estrogen deficiency in women who use DIMPA. The progesterone-only pill leads to reversible long-term amenorrhea in a minority of women due to complete suppression of ovulation. The LNG-releasing intrauterine device commonly results in amenorrhea after a few months. This is thought to be mainly a local effect, but suppression or ovulation can occur in some women. So how we have to approach for the secondary amenorrhea? I have said that it is a very common. So history, a good history can reveal the etiological diagnosis in up to 85% cases of amenorrhea. And in history, you have to rule out the pregnancy is very important. Then associate the symptom like galactorrhea, hirsutism, hot flashes, dry vagina, symptoms of thyroid disease. You have to ask for the recent changes in the body weight, recent emotional upset, previous menstrual and obstetrical history, previous surgeries, endometrial curettas or oophorectomy, previous abdominal, pelvic or cranial radiotherapy, family history of early menopause, drug history, progesterone, combined OC on chemotherapy. And in the examination, of course, BMI, sign of excess androgens, hirsutism, acne, sign of virilizations like deep voice, clitomegaly, sign of thyroid disease. Acanthicosis, nigrans for the PCOD, breast examination for galactorrhea and pelvic examination. And how you have to approach, then first you find out the pregnancy is not there, negative pregnancy test, then go for the TSH and prolactin and progesterone challenge test. If withdrawal bleeding is present, then most likely reason is an ovulation, manage accordingly. If without withdrawal bleeding, then you go for the estrogen progesterone challenge test, and if it is low and if it is hypoestrogenic, then FSH, go for the FSH. If it is low, then hypothalamic pituitary failure, and if FSH is high, then again repeated case could be premature ovarian failure. In the same way, if there is no withdrawal bleeding, then it could be compromised outflow tract obstruction, and it would be again negative in the progesterone estrogen progesterone challenge test. And if FSH is normal, most likely anatomical defect, and you can find out by HSC or hysteroscopy or HMN. So finally, if you come to the patient with the secondary amenorrhea, rule out pregnancy, TSH, prolactin, progesterone challenge test, then estrogen progesterone chair test, and by the FSH, you decide that what is the etiology. So complications and prognosis of amenorrhea. If a woman is having amenorrhea, what could be there? She can have osteoporosis, she can have a cardiovascular disease, and she is prone for the endometrial hyperplasia. Women with amenorrhea but not associated estrogen deficiency are at increased risk of endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial carcinoma. Infertility, women with amenorrhea generally do not ovulate. Psychological distress, this is a very important issue. Amenorrhea often causes anxiety. And the diagnosis of Turner syndrome, testicular feminization or developmental anomaly can be traumatic for both girls and their parents. So treatment of amenorrhea, of course, underlying causes like pituitary, you can do the bromocriptine surgery, androgen-producing tumor surgery, testicular feminization, remove gonad and HRT, Turner syndrome, HRT, imperforate hymen, surgical incision, thyroid disease in appropriate medical treatments, eating disorders referred to psychiatrists, PCOS appropriate treatment, Asherman syndrome, breaking down additions plus insert IUCDs. And if ladies trying to conceive, then again you have to think for the anovulation. And these patients, they respond well with the ovulation induction treatment. PCOS, we know that the total management, hyperprolactinemia, respond to treatment with dopamine agonist, hypothalamic dysfunctions, maintenance of of normal weight and changes of lifestyle. Asha means syndrome breaking down adenosine and ICT. And if they want regular periods, then use of COCs or HRT is the ideal. And if they need contraception, though confirmed ovarian failure will not require contraception, but if they are women are requiring, then OCPCR method of choice. So recent management of amenorrhea is the last slide, that ovarian cortical transplantation. This is a very important and recent update. The transplantation of ovarian cortical tissue is performed in patients with premature ovarian failure, premature menopause due to surgical removal of the ovary, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy. The ovarian cortical graft transplanted subcutaneously functioned from the 6th postoperative month. At the long-term follow-up of the patient, cortical grafts have still been functioning. So the patient did not have any complaint regarding hormonal therapy during that time period. Ultrasonographic appearance of follicles developed from subcutaneous graft at the end. 6, 9th, and 18 months. So this was the important issues related to amenorrhea. Thank you very much.
Bharti, amazing, amazing. And the whole topic, and especially the algorithm which you have shown, it is so nice and so clear. I think you will share. And everybody is very much benefited, because when the girls come to the, especially secondary amenorrhea, it was a challenge. And the point, especially to think of the Asherman, tuberculosis, especially in the younger women when we are not able to do an endometrial biopsy or anything. So this is very, very well crisply you have told everything. So now period na aane se, period jada aana. Heavy menstrual bleeding is another problem. Abhi aani raha tha, ab bahut jada aa raha hai. So from UP, we will go to the Bihar to Alka ji, and we will know about heavy menstrual bleeding, the new terminology given to us from the new palm coin method, AUB system 2 from the FIGO, that we no more using word DUB, polymenorrhea, menorrhagia. No, the term is heavy menstrual bleeding. Alka ji is associate professor, Department of OBGYN, PMCH, Patna. She is national corresponding editor, Jogi, chairperson, practical obstetric committee 2015 to 2017, president, Patna Obstetric Againi Society 2012 to 14, and now she is president-elect with Dr. Pai as East Zone Vice President. Over to you, Alka ji.
So thank you very much for your kind words. And respected Nandita ji, Lakshmi ji, and Ragini ji, dear conveners and esteemed panelists, a very good evening to all of you. And it is indeed a great pleasure to be with you and spend some time with you. And I thank Ragini ji from the core of my heart for giving me this opportunity. And I also thank Jackson Pal Pharma. So my topic today is heavy menstrual bleeding of more than 80 ml per menstrual cycle in two consecutive menstruations. It is excessive menstrual blood loss which interferes with a woman's physical, mental, and material quality of life. It can occur alone or in combination. So, menorrhea is blood loss of more than 80 ml per menstrual cycle in two consecutive menstruations, and a heavy menstrual blood loss which interferes with a woman's physical, emotional, and material quality of life, which can occur alone or in combination with other morbidities. The incidence ranges from 8% to 27% of females in reproductive age group. And in the developing countries, the incidence of abnormal bleeding affects about 5 to 15% of women of reproductive age, whereas in developed countries, the rate is expected as 30%. So, what is the impact on a woman's health of heavy menstrual bleeding? Anemia and ill health. Anxiety surrounding the symptom of menorrhagia due to she thinks that she may be having malignancy and ill health. Yeah. So what is the etiology? Figo has said, divided it into palm and groin classification. Palm involves the structure as polyps, adenomyosis, leiomyoma, other leiomyomas, malignancy, and hyperplasia. Whereas groin is associated with structural lesions such as coagulopathy, ovulatory dysfunction, endometrial problems, iatrogenic such as intrauterine copper device, and not yet classified. Now, how do we start investigating? We have to take a good history. We have to ask the woman whether her pads are soaking through one or more sanitary pads or tampons taken for several consecutive hours, whether she needs to use double sanitary pads, whether she needs to wake up to change the sanitary protection at night, the bleeding is longer than a week, then whether she passes clots which are larger than 1 centimeter, and whether she has to restrict her daily activities due to heavy menstrual blood flow. Now we have her psychological background involving stress or eating habits which may cause anovulatory heavy periods, then relevant drug history including aspirin or warfarin, such as Vibrance disease, then history of dysmenorrhea and ovulatory pain may indicate the presence of endometriosis and adenomyosis, and post-coital bleeding may suggest cervical pathology. Now, we do the signs of bloods and etiology of bleeding. Galactorrhea, thyroid abnormalities, pelvic examination, including a speculum examination, to identify any cervical or vaginal pathology. We also have to do a bimanual examination to note the amount and intensity of bleeding, identification of any uterine enlargement or irregularity or any adnexal lump. Now, how to investigate? Peripheral blood smear, blood typing and cross-matching, and pregnancy test. Then the other thrombocytopenia, prothrombin activated, partial thromboplastin time, fibrinogen, and then initial testing for von Willebrand disease we have to do. If we have, we do not find any other cause, and for factor 8. Then other lab tests which should be considered are thyroid stimulating hormone, serum iron, total iron binding capacity, ferritin, liver function tests, and test for chlamydia. Now, abdominal ultrasound has to be done. The ultrasound has superseded the abdominal ultrasound. Normally, thick endometrium may suggest polyps, endometrial carcinoma, and myelosis. So, this is an amplified view of the endometrium and may show endometrial polyps or submucous fibroids, which might be missed on TPS. Now, ultrasound is the gold standard. It allows examination of the whole endometrial cavity. Small polyps or mucous fibroids. Hysteroscopy with biopsy is the best diagnostic and intrauterine pathology, specificity and sensitivity. The endometrial sampling should be done with more than 45 years or younger than 45, the history of estrogen, obesity and CUS. So, the presence underlying cause of menstrual blood loss. going to be elicited, prostaglandins have been firmly implicated. Emerging evidence supports a role for cytotoxicity, prostaglandin, and prostaglandin receptor signaling pathways in the endometrium. These influence the promotion of angiogenesis and vasoactive materials. And prostaglandin 1 synthetase and prostacycline is significantly expressed during the menstrual phase of the cycle. And is a significant elevation in the expression of cyclooxygenase and prostaglandin metabolites in women with menorrhagia when compared with women with normal menses. So there may be functional variations contributing to idiopathic menorrhagia, and the response of myometrial blood vessels in whom idiopathic menorrhagia was significantly different with women with normal menses when these vessels were subjected in vitro to various vasoactive agents such as endothelin and medicine. Vessel tension mimicking vasoconstriction was shown to inhibit cyclooxygenase derived products. So management. The choice of management depends on the clinical stability, underlying cause of bleeding, need for future fertility, and other underlying medical problems. The mission for management is heavy bleeding control to reduce the menstrual blood in the forthcoming cycles. So we use hormonal, non-hormonal therapies, and surgery as a final option is also available. So what are the non-hormonal management? So first, exercise and healthy diet to control our weight. Effective yoga asanas help to control irregular periods. Then women suffering from HMD have been shown to have overactivation of the fibrinolytic system during the menstrual cycle. This accelerates the fibrin clot that forms pus, hemostasis, therefore an increase in fibrinolysis results in increased blood loss during endometrial shedding. So this is the pathway which shows that as men hit thrombin, they go to on fibrinogen. Factor 12 in thrombin, they act on fibrinogen to form fibrin, and plasminogen goes to act on this fibrin by converting itself into plasmin, and it results in fibrin degradation products. This is controlled by plasminogen activator factor and plasminogen activator inhibitors. Now, it reversibly blocks lysine binding sites on plasminogen, thus preventing plasmin from interacting with lysine residues on fibrin polymer, causing subsequent fibrin degradation. This is short half-life, taking regular administration of 1 gram only 3 to 4 times per day for periods, and elimination is via kidneys. Now, what are the contraindications? A woman who is suffering from kidney disease, she has acquired vision defects, active thromboembolic disease, or she is hypersensitive to tranexamic acid, and side effects after that. Therefore, the injection of tranexamic acid should be given very slowly. There may be convulsions, anaphylactic reactions, and GI upset. Now, efficacy has been found to be reduced to 20% in many cases, and it is significantly more effective than placebo, NSAIDs, ethambutolate, but reduces blood loss more than tranexamic acid. Combined oral contraceptives and tranexamic acid should not be used. Then NSAIDs, the cytokine TNF-alpha and FOXO2 are menstrual fluid of women with heavy bleeding, leading to increased prostaglandin signaling. NSAIDs exert their anti-inflammatory effect through inhibition of cyclooxygenase, which is the enzyme that catalyzes the transformation of arachidonic acid to prostaglandins and thromboxanes. Mefenamic acid is the most common use NSAID for treatment of heavy menstrual bleeding and results in a reported blood loss reduction of 25-50%. So, NSAIDs are less effective than tranexamic and NSAIDs in reducing blood flow, side effects, and should be avoided in women with and cognition disorders. NSAIDs and antifibrinolytics can be used together. During secretory phase of the menstrual cycle, progesterone is the dominant hormone and is a potent anti-inflammatory agent. After pregnancy, the corpus luteum regresses and progesterone levels sharply decline. It is this marked reduction in ovarian hormones that triggers an influx of inflammatory mediators to the endometrial environment, leading to shedding and menstruation. Maintenance of progesterone exposure limits endometrial inflammation and prevents menstruation. So it is not surprising that the most effective medical treatments available for heavy menstrual bleeding are hormonal preparations. So, IV equine estrogen 25 grams controls bleeding dramatically. Then, because it regenerates the endometrium, then progesterone is the most commonly used oral progesterone in the treatment of heavy menstrual bleeding. This should be prescribed 5 mg with take time daily from day 5 to 36 cycle, and this regimen has been shown to blood loss more than 1%.
I think Dr. Alka's connection is broken.
The combined oral and usually given for 3 weeks, followed by a pill-free week in which the woman experiences a hormone withdrawal. The pills produce an estimated reduction in blood loss of 50% and has the additional benefit of regulation of bleeding. The risks of pills are mainly due to estrogen content, contraindication, BMI over 35, smoke over 5 years of hypertensive women with vascular disease, migraine with aura, then current or recent breast cancer, history, family history of metabolic disease, and breastfeeding women.
Dr. Alka, aapki awaaz nahi aa rahi hai aur slide bhi move nahi kar rahi.
Inka internet ka issue hai.
Ma'am, inka internet unstable dikha raha hai.
Yeah. So, progesterone only pill is associated with irregular and unpredictable blood loss. And then we have injectable progesterone, which we can give, which has a high dose progesterone, can induce amenorrhea up to 50% of the user. Next slide, please, Dr. Alka. Then we have gonadotropin releasing hormone agonist. These are the synthetic peptides administered by IM, subcutaneous or intranasal route. And especially they are useful in the treatment of the uterine fibroids. And side effect, we all know the hyperestrogenism because of flushing, dryness, headache, decreased libido. And if you continue it more than 6 months, you need an add-back hormone replacement therapy. And calcium is needed along with this treatment. And this is my favorite, LNG IUS Mirena. It is a wonderful thing which has come to us, and it has really, really reduced the rate of at least hysterectomy if the patient is suffering from the DOB. A proper counseling is needed when you put this Mirena, because many a time it does not respond immediately. Patient can take time for 3 to 6 months to respond it properly. So it is a slowly released from the intrauterine delivery system to the local endometrial environment. And a very less dose, even the very, very micro dose has gone with this Mirena. And patient achieve hypomenorrhea, even amenorrhea after a year of the use. Next slide, please. Complication, unscheduled bleeding, infections, expulsion of IUS, and very rarely perforation, because it's a very soft plastic. The perforation is almost, I haven't seen a single case of the perforation with the LNG IUS. Next, so next we have some progesterone receptor modulator, and there are trials which have demonstrated control of HMG almost 90% women. And it is more quickly in the UPA group versus GnRH agonist. Danazol, usually, just to complete the list, we don't use usually danazol, although it is an effective, considered effective treatment for the heavy menstrual bleeding, because it has very strong effect of the androgen. Desmopressin, derivative of the antidiuretic hormone vasopressin, acts by the increasing plasma levels of the factor 8 and von Willebrand disease. It can be through intranasal inhalation, intravenous or subcutaneously. If everything fails, we know we have to go for the surgical intervention. DNC sometimes plays a role as a diagnosis, as far as the therapeutic effect also, to control the acute hemorrhage. Next slide, please. And uterine artery embolization is another thing. In our kitty, if we go for a not the radical method, and this uterine artery embolization is assessed through the femoral artery, and care must be taken to ensure a good, safe, stable position before embolization. And use of 2 to 3 French coaxial catheter is strongly recommended. And you need a team. Interventional radiologist with you. It is not available everywhere. So it is aim is to allow pulsatile arterial flow to carry the embolic particles to the microcirculation, and particles are injected into each artery until there's a complete or near arterial stasis. Essential to embolize both uterine arteries. Even it is very wonderful effect in the cases of the PPH on if patient is not being controlled before. If you have the facility, you can use the UAE before going for the hysterectomies. So all these contraindications and complications are very beautifully shown here. The suspected pregnancy, pelvic sepsis, fibroid expulsion can be there in the complication. And main thing is a delayed return of the menses, infection leading to hysterectomy. But still, we are not very sure it should be given to the women who are having, still want to have a child. So there's a trials for the versus myomectomy, no significant difference in technical success rate, symptom control. So it is totally up to you and your patient whether you want to go for the UAE or our simple straight myomectomy. The main thing is that usually when the patient comes, we don't talk about the myomectomy. We usually talk about the hysterectomy. That is the main thing. If you offer even the perimenopausal woman also myomectomy, and always have this first thing in our mind to further save the uterus if a single big fibroid. So many women, they only go for the myomectomy, not for the hysterectomies. And this is MRI guided focus ultrasound surgery. Madam, aapka wo theek ho gaya ho, toh you can take over. It represents an effective and almost non-invasive approach. Contraindication for this focused ultrasound therapy, suspected malignancy and pregnancy, acute inflammatory process. These are the absolute contraindication. Then uterus myoma, more than 5 myoma, over 10 centimeters, subserous pedunculated myoma. But the thing is that when these things we talk about, it is not available everywhere. You need a very big setup. It is not available for our single smaller middle sized nursing homes or hospitals. And the main thing is that we should all aware of, and when we talk to our patient, we should offer. No patient can say that you are not offered this therapy, new therapy to us before going for any surgical treatment. Patient should be make aware of these things. So there's a currently available case report shows that the next thing is a TCRE and the roller ball endometrial ablation, the first generation thermal ablation, minimally invasive surgical technique to treat the amenorrhagia, requires surgical expertise, and risk of the fluid overload and perforation of uterus and injury to the viscera may occur. The main thing with the TCRE, it is a very, very long learning course. Then came the endometrial ablation by the thermal balloon, which is also not available much, but the microwave and the bipolar radio frequency, these things is especially it is available and very much common in the Western country. People are doing, have revealed to no difference in treating menorrhagia, and level of surgical expertise is very low if we compare with the TCRENR. And this translated, the only thing with the this thing very comparatively much, much better is a less fluid overload. And recurrence might be possible, requiring further treatment. Next slide, ma'am. So, intrauterine balloon tamponade, effective method of the controlling acute bleeding, especially in PPH. Many times we use the Bakri balloon and the one technology, our own Dr. Nalini, she has given that balloon technology also. And then coming to the myomectomy, we all know it is myomectomy can be abdominal, can be laparoscopically, hysteroscopically, whatever the route you go for, you should be know that route, how to do the operation that time. The main problem is that if we start and stuck in between, then it can cause the problem. And for as far as the submucous myoma is concerned with the hysteroscopy, if it is very big and a part of the myoma is embedded inside the myometrium, always talk to the patient about the two-stage operation, because everybody can't be so proficient. Many a time you need a second operation, especially a very, very big myoma, like which complete cavity is obliterated. And if it is only 1/5 part is in the cavity and the bigger myoma in the myometrium, you can opt for the laparoscopic myomectomy also. So hysterectomy should be always the last part when you talk about the hysterectomy. Either all the management is failed or patient is really reaching to the menopausal era, then you go for the hysterectomy. For a perimenopausal woman, younger woman, 35 around, hysterectomy is not an answer. Today we have so many things in our kitty, as the whole presentation has shown. We should first go for them before going for the hysterectomy. Thank you so much. Again, hysterectomy, we know the route is up to you. Thank you, madam. And yes, the presentation was very good, very exhaustive. Although the main thing is that we all know that technology is supreme.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for now covering it up.
Yeah. Amenorrhea, menorrhagia, now pain. It is always when we talk about the menses, we talk about the dysmenorrhea. Starting from the day one, dysmenorrhea is there. The young girl having her first period, having too much of the pain, to the woman suffering from the endometriosis, and pain is the main thing. She comes in your chamber and say at the 30 years of the age, it's too much, I have two kids, doctor, take out my uterus. But is it really you will go for a hysterectomy for a 32 years old, even she is suffering from a dysmenorrhea? Over to Dr. Pratik Tambe, is a ART consultant and the gynae endoscopic surgeon. He has an international diploma in advanced laparoscopic surgery and trained in assisted reproduction in Brussels. He is chairperson of AMOX Endocrinology Committee, presently she is a governing council member, ICOG, executive committee member, ISAR, chairperson, FOCSI, endocrinology committee. He has just given it to Dr. Rakhi and is recipient of 15 mocks and 7 FOCSI prizes. List is very long. You talk about any FOCSI prize and it is in the kitty of Dr. Pratik Tambe. And editors of 10 books, 3 FOCSI focus, handbook, 11 key practice. When you really do practice, Dr. Tambe, this is really surprising. I think you are a superman. Over to you to deal with the dysmenorrhea.
Much, ma'am. At the outset, let me thank the respected Dr. Adini Agarwal ma'am for the kind invitation and the kind introduction as well. It's a wonderful session today, which is back to basics of OBGYN. And
should also place on record my gratitude to Dr. Vandana Punya and Dr. Anita Panwar, the President and Secretary of the Bhiwani Society, with whom today's program is associated. I'm sandwiched between some very eminent stalwarts on both sides, Dr. Bhati Maheshwari, Dr. Alka Pandey, and Dr. Kavita Papat. And I hope I'll be able to do justice to today's talk on dysmenorrhea. I usually like to start with a quotation, but today I thought I would change the order of the quotation. And I thought I'll put up something which is very relevant. And coming from a male perspective, I think this is particularly humbling. God made girls have monthly periods and give birth, because he knew guys weren't strong enough to handle it. So hats off to all of you women, and especially in this COVID era, all of you doctors, lady gynecologists, everybody who is fighting on the forefront of COVID-19 pandemic, my salutations and greetings to you. To talk about dysmenorrhea, we'll start with some basic and very boring stuff. It's painful menstrual cramps of uterine origin, usually classified as primary and secondary. Primary, where there's no identifiable organic pathology, and secondary, where you have an identifiable condition. Usually the onset is immediately after menarche, within 6 to 12 months, and the duration is 8 to 72 hours during the menses. This is, of course, for primary dysmenorrhea that we are talking about. In fact, if you look at the systematic reviews which have been published over the past couple of decades, the first one from 1996 actually says that dysmenorrhea occurs at some point of time in almost every single woman's life. It's almost 95% that the incidence is shown here. Whereas from a systematic review in 2002, nearly 50% of adults and 75% of adolescents reported dysmenorrhea. Nearly 1 in 5 women found the condition to be debilitating enough to prevent daily activities. As far as secondary dysmenorrhea is concerned, and we'll talk a little bit about this in more detail, because this is primarily what we as OBGYNs would deal with more commonly. The most common cause, unfortunately, is endometriosis. As we all know, it's a silent disease, and it has now been estimated through a recent RBM online article, which was published in 2015, that 62% of adolescents who present with dysmenorrhea will actually have endometriosis, which is not overtly revealed until you investigate further in detail. Adenomyosis is also more commonly being diagnosed today because of advances in imaging techniques. In the good old days, if you remember the ultrasound reports from our radiology colleagues who used to do transabdominal ultrasound because transvaginal probes are not so commonly available, heterogeneous echo texture of myometrium is a standard line which is there in almost every ultrasound scan of a woman who is 35 plus. And some of these so-called, in inverted commas, heterogeneous echo texture, if you look at with a high resolution transvaginal probe, or if you do an MRI, then this would turn out to be adenomyosis. And sometimes adenomyosis can only be diagnosed with the help of these advanced imaging techniques. The list of why secondary dysmenorrhea occurs and the causative agents or etiologies is extensive. I've just reproduced this table here to put everything into perspective. It's only a 15 to 20 minute talk. I'm not going to be able to do justice by talking about all of these conditions. I'll only tackle the most important common conditions, and my aim would be to more focus on the treatment aspect and what is the evidence as it stands today when it comes to treatment of dysmenorrhea. In fact, there's a study from Gothenburg in Sweden which looked at the factors which are associated with severity, and they said that if the duration of flow was more, if the age at menarche was younger, if the woman had been herself smoking or exposed to tobacco in some form of tobacco or another, like passive smoking, then the incidence of dysmenorrhea was much more. And the reason why this is because tobacco smoke, nicotine, and all the other agents which are present in smoke are supposed to have a vasoconstrictive effect and supposed to release prostaglandins, which contribute to the incidence of extensive dysmenorrhea. Speaking about prostaglandins, I think no talk on dysmenorrhea would be complete unless we looked at the pathophysiology and how cyclooxygenase system is activated through a variety of mechanisms in all these different conditions. This is the final common pathway if you look at a cellular level, where prostaglandin E2 and F2 alpha are released, which lead to myometrial constriction, vasoconstriction, and there is hypersensitization of the local pain fibers, which leads to dysmenorrhea. In fact, it has further been postulated that in addition to peripheral pain sensitization, there is also a central sensitization which occurs at a cortical level because of peripheral nociceptive input. And this recurrent feedback leads to a central sensitization. This is obviously going to have its own impact on the quality of life of the woman, her relationships, school and work-related performance, and of course, her social and recreational activities. Quite often you will see that young girls, adolescents, or college-going girls are taking breaks from school and college during those difficult days because they have such crippling dysmenorrhea that they are unable to deal with it even with medical management. So let's focus now on the treatment aspect. Is there a simple algorithm which we can implement in clinical practice? And this is from an article which I found in Human Reproduction Update, which talks about taking a detailed history, going into the antecedents, trying to identify the causative factors which are leading to dysmenorrhea, whether it's primary or secondary, and then going on to further investigate and treat the disease. If you look at the differential diagnosis, as we said earlier, there's an exhaustive list, and by no means I'm going to be able to do justice. But just to mention briefly that you have endometriosis, you can also have chronic pelvic inflammatory disease, and in India, especially in the younger age group, silent reproductive tract infections, incompletely treated infections, or sometimes even undiagnosed infections, like if you see chlamydia or gonorrhea, can be the causative agents. Adenomyosis and endometriosis, we'll talk about in a little more detail in the second half of this talk. I'm not going to be talking about fibroids because that has been extensively covered in the previous talk. Rarely you can have ectopic pregnancy, but that's something which only masquerades, and that's just here for the sake of completion. One condition which we are seeing more and more frequently in modern practice is something called as interstitial cystitis. And this sometimes may be associated in the perimenstrual period of the month. And you may have this as one of the rare presenting differentials for dysmenorrhea. The million-dollar question: how do you treat it? What are the different agents that are available to us? And which pharmacotherapeutic agents are recommended and evidence-based in clinical practice? If you look at a Cochrane meta-analysis, which was published in 2006, there were 26 RCTs and a variety of pharmacological agents, chiefly NSAIDs, were identified. And the study concluded, the meta-analysis concluded by saying that there is no significant difference between individual NSAIDs. And you can see the laundry list there, which includes mefenamic acid, which all of us usually reserve as a first-line agent. There's diclofenac, nimesulide, naproxen, ibuprofen, and even meloxicam, which is a derivative of pyroxicam. In fact, if you look at the recommendations for family physicians, you will see three or four different drugs which are mentioned, and all of them are supposed to be equally efficacious. It doesn't matter which NSAID you use. It seems that all of them work equally well. Your choice and patient compliance should probably be the only two important criteria used for prescribing what particular agent over the other. And furthermore, the meta-analysis goes on to say that when you compare with placebos, NSAIDs reduce pain after 8 to 12 hours. When you compare with aspirin, NSAIDs are much more effective. When you compare with paracetamol, NSAIDs may be equally effective. And if you have the particularly difficult patient who has very bad spasmodic dysmenorrhea, all you may need to do is keep her in an OPD basis or admit her for a brief period of time and give her IV paracetamol, and that will probably work just as well as anything else. When you compare it with alternative therapies like acupressure, NSAIDs seem to be equally effective or more effective, and they reduce the restriction of daily activities and increase the ability to work. The second option that we need to discuss is combined oral contraceptives. And we have here another meta-analysis which looks at 5 RCTs with nearly 400 women. And they found that when estrogen content was more than 35 micrograms, that is the first and the second generation COCs to be very specific, there was no difference in pain relief with COCs and placebo. So traditionally, though all of us have been prescribing cyclical oral contraceptive pills for months and sometimes even years together, even to somebody who is unmarried or in an adolescent age group, the evidence doesn't always bear that out. And this is for the older first and second generation estrogen plus progesterone combinations. If you look at the more modern pills, which have an even lower concentration of estrogen, the subsequent RCTs also do not show significant benefit. So are these OC pills, which we are prescribing left, right, and center, truckloads of them, actually of any benefit? Maybe they have a placebo effect. Maybe they help to regulate the hormonal levels at a subclinical level, which we are not able to pick up. But most of the RCTs and the meta-analysis show that they are not of significant benefit in controlling primary dysmenorrhea. There is something called as transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. And those of you who have patients with orthopedic issues and chronic backache may have come across this particular methodology of treatment. And compared with placebo, high frequency TENS seems to reduce the pain. And when you compare them with NSAIDs, the evidence is very low quality. Therefore, you can't really compare them. If you have somebody who has intractable pain, is not able to have any benefit with the standard classical NSAIDs that we prescribe, then probably this is one avenue that is worthwhile looking into. It's freely available. Most physiotherapists or orthopedic surgeons will be able to direct you to a particular practitioner who is able to give you TENS on an OPD basis. This is an interesting study which I found, and this is off the beaten track. And the reason I'm putting it up here is that usually we have very rarely any Indian studies which are published and which are actually referred to. This is an Indian study with more than 550 adolescent girls who have been prescribed vitamin B1, that is thiamine, 100 milligrams daily for 2 to 3 months. And you'll be surprised to find that more than 50% of them reported improvement, which is significantly more than the population who was prescribed placebo. So how does this work? We don't really know. Is it just a placebo effect? Probably not. But there is some kind of dietary deficiency with amino acids and vitamins, which may be underlying, which we still don't understand. And sometimes these co-prescriptions of vitamins like vitamin E and thiamine may be of benefit to your patients. Have I used it personally? No. But maybe if you use it tomorrow in your daily practice, you might find some significant improvement. Vitamin E, I just referred to a couple of minutes ago, and this is given as 500 international units from 2 days before the onset of the period until the third day of menses. And you'll find that 2 out of 3 patients reported significant benefit with just a simple co-prescription along with an NSAID of vitamin E. Like I said, the jury is still out whether this will work in your clinical practice. At least they are not very expensive drugs, and it can be easily co-prescribed with a standard NSAID. The last part of the talk is to talk about herbal medicine, complementary medicine, and then a little bit about endometriosis, and then I will close. There are some alternative therapies which have been widely prescribed or widely recommended in layperson's world, if so to speak. These include fish oil, rose tea, acupressure, and whether they are better than placebo, there is no evidence, but there may be some benefit and your mileage may vary. There are some laparoscopic procedures for dysmenorrhea, and I'm just putting these up to complete the entire gamut of therapies that we have available at our fingertips. And these include the laparoscopic uterine nerve ablation and the presacral neurectomy. Typically, these are prescribed for patients who have intractable chronic pelvic pain. It's not really a prescription or a therapy which is referred to for patients who have simple primary or secondary dysmenorrhea. And Luna may reduce pain at 12 months and it is less effective than presacral neurectomy. However, there aren't many skilled practitioners who are able to offer this surgery, and I was not able to find extensive Indian studies of these two methods. Just keep this in the back of your mind that if you have somebody with chronic pelvic pain, then these are surgeries which you can offer them, and this is something which is well documented. Let's talk a little bit about endometriosis. In the first part of the talk, I said that up to 60% of all adolescents who present with pain, and this pain typically will not ameliorate with simple standard NSAIDs, may actually be suffering from endometriosis. Now, we've been taught that there is a classic triad of infertility, dysmenorrhea, and dyspareunia in endometriosis. Obviously, in an adolescent girl, infertility and dyspareunia is not going to be a presenting complaint, and all you are left with is dysmenorrhea. Often we dismiss these girls by saying that nahi pehle 3-4 mahine mein aise hi hota hai, pehle 1-2 saal aise hi hota hai, normal hai, kuch nahi, goli le lo, theek ho jayega. But it is important for us to not dismiss them out of hand and make sure that we investigate, identify, and exclude endometriosis as one of the causes. In fact, in the old days, we used to require a laparoscopic diagnosis and sometimes even a tissue biopsy to identify endometriosis. Today, there is a paradigm shift in the approach to treatment of these girls, and it's a presumptive diagnosis based on history, clinical examination, imaging studies, sometimes biomarkers, but the most important is response to therapy when you administer medical management. So diagnostic and operative laparoscopy is typically not required for a diagnosis in adolescents, and it's not to be recommended anymore. Primary medical management is now the order of the day. I'm not going to talk about laparoscopy. We are aware of what the laparoscopic staging is, but what I will refer you to is the algorithm for management and diagnosis of endometriosis, especially in young girls or adolescent girls who present to you with intractable dysmenorrhea, which is not the classic standard primary dysmenorrhea, which we say goli lo theek ho jayega. Try and do an ultrasound if possible. Obviously, transvaginal is not possible. If MRI is available to you, patient is affording, then MRI is supposed to have very good sensitivity and specificity, especially for deep infiltrating endometriosis, stage 3 and stage 4 disease. And the last gold standard is, of course, laparoscopy and biopsy. There are better markers which are today available, more than the CA-125, and they are not widely available in India, but maybe in another 4 to 5 years' time, they will become more commonly available and we'll be able to diagnose it in terms of biomarkers. As far as the algorithm for management of adolescent endometriosis goes, the first choice of therapy remains a Dynogest, which is administered in a dose of 2 milligrams per day. You can give it safely for a period of up to 5 years, and all the standard evidence which is there today shows that the efficacy of Dynogest is very high as far as pain relief is concerned, and the cost of therapy is reasonably low. As far as efficaciousness is concerned, all the standard parameters of dyspareunia, diffuse pelvic pain, dysmenorrhea, and premenstrual pain are significantly lowered with a therapy which goes beyond 20 to 24 weeks, as you can see from the trials. And as far as the duration of treatment is concerned, these are studies from Japanese patients. Actually, an interesting tidbit here is that Dynogest was first licensed for use in Japan way back in 1995. And some of the longest follow-up that we have regarding this molecule comes from Japan. Why it's more common in Japan, we don't really know. Maybe it has something to do with being rice eaters or coastal country or exposure to sea or toxins or something like that, we don't really know. But you will see that in up to 60 months or 5 years, it's very effective and reduces the incidence of recurrence to as low as 2% at 5 years. So if you are suspecting endometriosis, especially in an adolescent, please try out Dynogest. It's a very helpful therapy. It does help to reduce the pain as well as improve the quality of life and can be safely administered long term. Just two slides about fertility preservation. In patients who you suspect to have endometriosis, please try and refer them for oocyte cryopreservation and freezing. We had this beautiful lady called Diana Hayden who had two children after having frozen her eggs 7 years earlier, she herself being an endometriosis sufferer. And this is our chief guest of today, our past president FOCSI, Dr. Nandita Palchetkar, speaking about fertility preservation. I'm going to close with some simple take-home messages. Dysmenorrhea, probably after amenorrhea, is the most common menstruation-related complaint that all of us OBGYNs face in day-to-day practice. It's important to identify the cause where it's possible. Try not to dismiss the patient saying, sab theek ho jayega, goli le lo, femene mein okay ho jayega. Try and identify the cause for secondary dysmenorrhea if present. Evidence-based principles we've already covered. We've talked about the algorithms. We've also talked about the preferred choice of NSAIDs, PNS, where it's available. And of course, we've talked about endometriosis at length. I'll close by saying that the greater the difficulty, the more the glory in surmounting it. Skillful pilots gain their reputation from storms and tempests. Thank you, Dr. Agini Agarwal, for making me part of this fantastic program. And I wish you all the very best. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Prateek, for giving such a crisp lecture. And I can say after this lecture that misery will continue and enwrapped in the mystery is still the diagnosis you are doing or not. It will continue. And the one message from this whole lecture, what I can say, we should take that young girl, when she is coming with the intractable dysmenorrhea, many times we lose the time of diagnosing endometriosis and the diagnosis of endometriosis when we are able to diagnose, it will be too late for her fertility quotient. So always aware, a girl coming with a severe dysmenorrhea, think of the endometriosis and treat her. Now, no guy, you don't need to prove that woman is having a endometriosis. The medical management can be started without any that gold standard of the laparoscopy to diagnosing the endometriosis. And with this, we are coming to the last part, covering all three miseries. And for that, we have Dr. Kavita Bapat with us. I will introduce her with a charming smile and the twinkling light, the way I always remember Kavita, with a golden heart and too much brain.
Love you always.
This is Kavita and we are all waiting for Indore. We don't want to miss the Indore, all the Indore hospitality on the virtual AICOG. God bless us and we will go in physical way to Indore to enjoy the AICOG, next AICOG in Indore. So I will not go in, you have all read it. Welcome Kavita and start your
talk. Thank you so much, Ragini. Abhi do hi baatein hoti hain. Vice President mein sabse number one Vice President kaun? Ragini Agarwal. She is doing so much work and all the thing. I just love the topic. Allow me to share my screen probably. Yeah, that's I will share. Thank you. So the Vice President mein sabse achha Vice President and then the topic is so good. I just love the topic, revisiting menstruation, mystery and misery. Sorry, Miss, Mrs., Mistress, sari troubledness wale problems say of all the problems of this. And respected Nandita Madam and Lakshmi Shikhande, as they are not there. And so nice that to have this program, Dr. Ragini, along with the Chandan. And Chandan is, I think it's a co-twin person to you. She's such a darling person, always with you. And I think all the programs which you do, I think she is the hardcore person with you. I really
Thank you, ma'am.
Should be very happy to have friends like this. And after the elaborate lecture by Alka Madam and Bharti is so sweet. She always speaks sweet. And Pratik to hero hi hai sabka aajkal. So my topic today is postmenopausal bleeding. And it's basically, I'll just let you know in last 30 years, what I feel about postmenopausal bleeding is, hum log itne aage aa gaye hain postmenopausal. I was a student when we used to have a patient of postmenopausal bleeding, one and only treatment hota tha, either surgery or let her die or something like that, or not investigated. And in last 30 years, we are finding so much difference in the treatment, in the manner of treatment, in making decisions, in making saving the uterus. Another the important point for the postmenopausal bleeding, so many more things. But I just put up a few things, what this definition of menopause is all of no permanent cessation of menstruation, have stopped menstruating for 12 months. And the note, the mean age of menopause is 58, 51, and normal range from 46 to 56. In India, it has been declared that the average age for the menopause is 46 to 48 years. And so the postmenopausal bleeding, because longevity is there. So more chances of postmenopausal bleeding is there. Now, postmenopausal bleeding is a bleeding from the genital tract occurring at 1 year following the cessation of spontaneous menstruation, and it is serious symptoms which may indicate the presence of malignant disease in the genital tract. So whenever the patients of PMB comes, the first and the foremost thing we should be worried about the genital tract cancers, and every woman to the PMB should be assumed to have a carcinoma until full investigation has proved to do. So the PMB patient is emergency. It's just like an obstetric emergency. I'm telling you, we should not leave the patient of postmenopausal bleeding as it is. It's a real, real dire emergency. We should counsel her, we should treat her, we should find out what is the cause. So the case-based approach, I'm just telling you, in day-to-day practice, we find this type of patient. A 65-year-old patient complains of vaginal bleeding 3 months, last menstrual period at the age of 52 because of the late menopause, we can say. She has not taken any hormonal replacement therapy, diagnosed with a type 2 diabetes, and treated with the oral hypomagnesemic drug, chronic hypertension, treated with antihypertensive. Her height is 160 and weight is 90 kg. I'm sure each of us should have this type of patient in our life with her diabetes, chronic hypertension, postmenstrual bleeding, too much BMI, and the small height and a small stature or like that. And the age is like this. So now what should be the approach for this? The number one and the foremost thing is history. History is very, very important. When she had a last period, when she had a bleeding started, what is the precipitating factor, such as trauma is also very important. Now, what is the nature of the bleeding as a normal pattern, duration, postcoital cervical polyp quantity, then the HISCR risk factors for the endometrial carcinoma like diabetes, hypertension, high BMI, late menopause, nulliparity, and use of unopposed estrogen. Sometimes patient comes with a PMB and she takes some homeopathy, allopathy, what not for whatever, and she comes with a postmenopausal bleeding. Any associated symptoms such as pain, fever, changes in the bladder and bowel function are should be there. And the personal family history of bleeding disorders, medical history, medications, HRT being taken, having the coital relation, past obstetric, surgical, and the last most important, when the smear being done in our country. It's not a normal thing that the patient will have a smear report, and because we don't have the universal screening program in our country, though we need it very, very badly. And this is it's a time that we should inculcate and propagate the universal screening program, and this is needed. Now, approach the clinical examination is simple things. We should go directly. General and systemic examination, systemic illness, indications, obesity, thyroid, pallor, pulse, BP, weight loss, cachexia. Weight loss is another most important thing for PMB. And any fever, careful examination, external, internal genitalia, and we'll find out. The PS examination is very, very important, because postmenopausal patients having a simple, small things, determine the bleeding sites are there, a bladder, rectum, vulva, vagina, cervix, uterus, from where the bleeding is coming. The suspicious lesion, the tumor, foreign body, laceration, cervical polyp, sometimes the simple atrophic vaginitis is the cause for postmenopausal bleeding. And we start thinking about the big endometrial carcinoma, and sometimes it's a simple senile atrophic vaginitis. Sometimes the postmenopausal bleeding may be due to small urethral caruncle at the urethra. And patient comes with the bleeding and it's treated and thought of a very big thing. Sometimes there is an ulceration, ring passeriously, and size, contour, tenderness of the uterus is also very important. But rectal examination should be done in a cases of postmenopausal bleeding, because sometimes it's a rectal thing also. Now the atrophic vaginitis, the majority of women be found with the atrophic vaginitis, and whereas the vaginal epithelium thins and break into the response to the low estrogen level, it's a benign condition, relatively easily treated with the topical estrogen. So it's a very common, and that patient only needs assurance and a local treatment, that's all. Now the cervical polyps. Sometimes we find out the cervical polyps also. And cervical polyp is a very small one, and it can be treated with a remolid polyps, remove under the direct visualization, or sometimes the hysteroscopy is being needed and can be done. Now the cervical smear in a postmenopausal bleeding is important. We should do it. Colposcopy, what I always talk about, if the report will come HIL, LIL, SIL, then only we will do the colposcopy. Just think sometimes if we can visualize the cervix, if you're able to visualize the cervix, we should do it. And then the role of endometrial biopsy. Endometrial biopsy is a part of investigation, is a part of examination. Both we can talk about, and that can be done by the Pipel endometrial suction curate or the Vibra aspirator or a simple endometrial brush. We can just have it as an examination or an investigation. It's a old method, DNC, but the latest gold standard is hysteroscopy, and visualization to allow the uterine cavity can be done. Now again about the hysteroscopy. Now the management part. What the investigation? Simple, complete blood count, coagulation profile. Coagulation profile for the postmenopausal bleeding is very important, because sometimes they are having on some medicines like a statin or khun patla karne wali goli or hard ki dawaiyan. Many more medicines they take patients, and the coagulation profile is not being done. And this is the one of the cause for the postmenopausal bleeding. So we should look about it. AFT, RFT, X-ray, chest should be done. Now, the most important, a simple can be diagnosed the postmenopausal bleeding and can be treated by a simple ultrasound. And endometrial thickness is very, very important. Measurement of the endometrial thickness by transvaginal sonography, important role for the uterine malignancy or not malignancy. And the cutoff is very, very important. That's a 4 to 5 millimeter ultrasonography suggestive of endometrial pathology in such women. Unfortunately, ultrasonography cannot be used and replace the endometrial biopsy as means to exclude the endometrial cancer, but still we should trust a good sonography, putting a Doppler, putting a color, and putting the uterine artery flow and everything, and we can find it out this thing. And sometimes we need a saline sonohistogram to exclude that from the polyp. Should do it. And this is a very simple, and we find out many more things. Now, the most important role I always talk about, when the patient of PMB comes, if the uterine thickness is more than 5, 6, 7, cause should not be the point. MRI is one of the very important diagnostic aid for the patients of PMB, postmenopausal bleeding, because it gives a bigger picture. It gives the decision making. It gives the many more things, what we are planning, what we are going to do, what we are going to have. So though it's expensive, but very, very important, an evaluation of the endometrial thickness and predict the invasion. The invasion is very, very important, as well as the presence of the lymph nodes, the aortic, and all the lymphatic drainage should be ruled out before diagnosing anything about this. And MRI for the early stage cancer. And CA125, it has got a role, but it should be done for the cancer tumor mark. Now, how to postmenopausal bleeding, transvaginal ultrasonography, endometrium less than 4, repeat sonography in 4 to 12 months, bleeding continues, and normal finding secretory proliferative in endometrium. Endometrium more than 4, all the story begins. Diffusely thickened endometrium, endometrial biopsy, and abnormal finding, treat based on the diagnosis. Focal mass or a thickening, which are very, very worried about. Focal thickening of the endometrium, hysteroscopy is needed. So it's very, very simple algorithm for any postmenopausal bleeding. Postmenopausal bleeding, they are already the old patient. The family sometimes is over worried about them and sometimes least bothered about them. So I, from my experience of last so many years, the either they are so much hyper ki postmenopausal bleeding ho gaya, matlab kya hoga, and sometimes kya madam pata nahi kya ho gaya. So these, we should go through this algorithm and we'll find out. Now the causes, just to make a list of it, uterus mein endometrial carcinoma, leiomyosarcoma, sarcoma, hyperplasia, and endometritis. In a cervix can be a cervical carcinoma, cervicitis, cervical polyp, cervical trauma. And a vagina carcinoma, atrophic vaginitis, vaginal trauma, sometimes foreign body, and especially the this vaginal pessaries. Now, another vulvar is the vulvar dystrophies, vulvar trauma. And other like a fallopian tumor, carcinoma, secondary tumors, ovarian breast, colorectal carcinoma, urethral carcinoma. Now, these are the systemic causes we should be worried about. Thrombocytopenia, leukemia, pancytopenia, anticoagulant therapy. Sometimes these patients are on hormonal replacement therapy and they have some spotting. Sometimes estrogen producing tumors. And then the last one is the peripheral conversion of the androstenedione. So we should be worried about. Now the most common etiology, atrophic vaginitis, estrogen therapy, endometrial cervical polyp, hyperplasia, carcinoma, and cervical carcinoma. Now the endometrial carcinoma, natural history, simple hyperplasia, no ATPR, complex hyperplasia, no ATPR. Complex hyperplasia with ATPR and endometrial carcinoma. Treatment, simple hyperplasia, no ATPR, progesterone. Complex hyperplasia, no ATPR, progesterone. Complex hyperplasia with ATPR. This patient needs hysterectomy or progesterone. And endometrial carcinoma is a minimal invasive surgery with bilateral cervical oophorectomy is the treatment. I'm just putting a two slides onto the endometrial carcinoma because second most gynecological cancer and arising from the lining of the uterus account 10% of the postmenopausal bleeding. So we are worried about the most important point, and these are the four stages: confined to the body, involves cervix, outside the uterus and cervix, and extended to the bladder and rectum. The treatment need a postoperative adjuvant radiation therapy, recurrent risk, and confined to endometrium, no invasion. Uterine muscle requires only surgery, and the cancer has deeply invaded the uterine muscle and spread outside. The prognosis is good, and this is as detected as early. So these are the stages. I'm not into it. Now the approach is definitive treatment. The condition after diagnosis treated according to the underlying cause. Now this is the take-home message. With the 30 years of experience of many of all of us sitting over here, listening to it, what has changed? Any postmenopausal bleeding should be taken seriously and investigated. We should counsel her and we should be bothered about anything. If recurrent, good to take out uterus. No fear, not feeling bad. HRT should never be prolonged. If it's being given or something, it should not be prolonged. So thank you so much for the patient hearing. The postmenopausal bleeding is very close to my heart because I am only a vaginal gynec surgeon, and most of the time patient comes with this type of complaint. And they already shown three, four gynecologists before, and they've come for the opinion. So in my opinion, MRI is really important for postmenopausal bleeding. And this is the advent and new thing in the scenario of PMD. So it should be done. Thank you so much for patient listening and giving me the chance, Ragini, for today. I just like the subject and you gave me the subject. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kavita, for putting this difficult subject in such a beautiful way and in such a concise way. The take-home message for this PMB is number one thing. When the patient comes to you, don't send for an ultrasound immediately. First, examine her, because all patients, maybe cancer is always on the priority list, but every patient does not have a gynecological malignancy. The most common thing which I have come across is a polyps. Many times the big cervical polyp is there. The patient is running pillar and post, having a 3, 4, 5, 6 ultrasound. Endometrial thickness is within normal limit. What to do? Please do a paraspeculum examination. That is a must. Don't forget your own hand and your own speculum and eyes. And the second thing which is very important is thinking of the atrophic vaginitis, with which many patients come with a bleeding. And third most important message which Dr. Kavita has given is a MRI. Don't talk about the cost always, because sometime saving a little bit money is more dangerous than spending it. So And fourth message, which I really loved it, is if she is bleeding. I'm a person who is totally for the save uterus. I don't do hysterectomy until unless patient, it's really not possible to save the uterus. But if woman is postmenopausal, be liberal. If she is bleeding and you're not even finding some cause, but she's coming and coming with a recurring bleeding, it is better to remove it. That is must. Because sometime they have a very early stage of the cancer and you are not able to find it. So with this, I think we have covered most of the miseries and the mysteries, but it is unending topic. So over to you, Chandan, if there is some question, we can...
There is a question. In a girl, 25 years of heavy menstrual bleeding on progesterone therapy, day two FSH is 20, what to do next? I think this should be to the speaker who spoke about menorrhagia. So Dr. Alka.
Anybody can take.
Anybody can take, ma'am, that question.
What's the question?
25 years old, heavy menstrual bleeding on progesterone therapy. Day two, FSH is 20. What to do next?
FSH is 20. I think basically the FSH is 20 is nothing to worry about the FSH is 20. So it's not on the right side and she's taking the progesterone. We should look for all the pathologies inside also. What is the size of uterus? What is the thickness of the uterus? What is the endometrium? What are the ovaries situation? Are there something in the ovaries also? We will find it out. And all with the algorithm of AUB coin, we should differentiate each of the cause of AUB and make it which AUB it is. So if you reach to the point that which AUB it is, we will be able to diagnose. And this type of patient works best with the LNG. What I feel about, what's the age you say about the patient?
25. She is married or not married.
What is the marital status? How many kids she have? And what the planning, fertility, infertility? So many things.
Yeah.
Only 25 years having a bleeding, taking progesterone is not the answer for the all.
Not the answer.
I think we need a proper history. More history and more investigation.
Okay, Tambe, you want to add something? FSH 20 at the 25 years. Seems to
somebody
me.
Somebody who's been on progesterone already, your FSH LH levels can be abnormal. What is normally recommended is that if you want to look at FSH LH, you have to give a withdrawal bleed. And then on the second or the third day, then you assess. While somebody is already on hormones, your FSH LH hormonal levels may not be very much diagnostic, or they may not indicate the correct pathology.
That's troublesome.
Yeah. So there is a question for Dr. Bharti. In case of amenorrhea, how long the use of OCP is recommended? Dr. Bharti is there?
Yeah. Bharti is there.
Yes, ma'am, please unmute yourself.
Hear me?
Yeah.
In case of amenorrhea, COCs, I think I have seen the question she was asking for what purpose she wants to use COC. If she is wanting for the estrogen progesterone withdrawal bleeding, then of course for 1, 2, 3 cycles. But if she is asking for bringing the menstruations, of course when she is asking for the amenorrhea, so it should be responded in the 3 months if she is taking POCs continuously for the withdrawal bleeding.
There's another question. Role of acyclical progesterone for menorrhagia in perimenopausal age group. Ideally, for how long we have to use? Anybody can take that question.
So anybody who is perimenopausal always first needs to be evaluated to confirm that there is no palpable pelvic pathology, as we used to be taught in the good old days. As long as there is no organic pathology, you can give cyclical progesterone, and that can be given for up to 3 cycles. But in a perimenopausal age group, I would be very careful, because first you need to evaluate, look at the endometrium, do a hysteroscopy, ensure that the ovaries are fine, there is no functioning cyst in the ovaries, and rule out all possible organic pathology before you say that everything is normal. This is just a hormonal disturbance and we are trying to correct the hormonal disturbance by giving cyclical progesterone.
Thank you, sir. There's another one for you only. Any role of proanthocyanamide to treat the dysmenorrhea?
Yeah, I saw that question a little while earlier. So proanthocyanidin is actually a co-prescription with L-arginine. It's a nutritional supplement. And as far as nutritional supplements go,
vitamin E. You already talked about it.
Yeah, vitamin E.
Vitamin E and thiamine.
B1. Yeah. These two have a proven role. Regarding the others, I'm not sure if there is any evidence.
So I have taken that message from you. I will start giving that. That's all. We had all these questions.
Thank you so much.
There's one more. 13 years old girl with heavy bleeding and pain in abdomen. Ultrasound shows right hydrosulfinx. What should be the management? 13-year-old girl.
Investigate for tuberculosis.
Tuberculosis, so dekh lo.
Tuberculosis, haan. Hydrosulfinx hai, toh tuberculosis dekhna padega.
We have to. I think the balancing between when to start the surgery is very necessary. We should not prolong also any surgical intervention. So this balancing, first evaluation, then balancing between the medical and the conservative surgical treatment should be always there.
In young adolescents and unmarried girls, while using endogest for long duration, interval period is in between 3 months is required or not? Any essential investigation monitoring them? Dr. Pratik.
So endogest is typically vaginal progesterone. I don't know whether she is referring to endogest or dinogest.
I think she is talking about dinogest. Dinogest
is typically to be given without a break, without cyclical fashion, uninterrupted for a minimum period of 3 to 6 months to see benefits. If you give it any shorter or if you give it in a cyclical fashion, it's not going to be as effective.
So, is there any scientific evidence of dinogest with the breast carcinoma?
As far as dinogest is concerned, there is no evidence that it itself causes breast carcinoma. But there are certain studies which say that fourth generation progestins, if you prescribe for a longer period of time, patient may be prone to DVT. That is the most common side effect which is normally referred to. As far as dinogest studies are concerned, it doesn't have any role as far as these complications are concerned.
No role. Even a patient of CA breast can be given the dinogest.
Mainly the metroxyprogesterone is the considered the biggest culprit for the breast carcinoma. So, questions are finished?
Finished, yes. Will LNG IUD work in small 1.5 centimeter submucous fibroid in a 47-year-old?
Try karlo.
Try karlo.
दे सकते हैं और फिर देख सकते हैं. We can take it out anytime. With proper counseling, yes, definitely.
One should have a biopsy, I think.
Biopsy first and then put.
I think.
So we will take a call today.
Yeah,
yes,
you.
That's all, ma'am. That was all. Thank you so much.
Although Vandana is not able to join, thank you, Bhivani. You are always there with me to give us support. Thank you so much.
We learned a lot today and we will be applying that to our practice. Thank you so much.
Dr. Agni and Dr. Chandan and nice to meet you, Dr. Pratik, Dr. Kavita, and heard all good talk. So it's really very good.
And thank you everyone who has joined today and they are here till the end. Thank you so much everyone. We will come again tomorrow.
Pratik sir, namaste.
Tomorrow is 15th. It's a 4 to 7 for labor update. Again, very basics. Thank you, Jackson Pal.
Thank you.
Right, I'm thanking everybody on behalf of Jackson Pal, the makers of JP-Tone Iron Syrup, which is enriched with zinc and vitamin B, can say no to anemia. We have Cyclorex CR10, that is controlled release tablet of norethisterone 10 mg in postponement of menstruation. Enderic tablet containing 2 mg dinogest for endometriosis associated pelvic pain, and our Doxypal DRL, doxycycline. So my teammates join me, Dr. Deepika, to thank all the experts present here today. We are truly appreciative of the presence of all the attendees also. With your unending support, we hope to go a long way in knowledge sharing. We express our gratitude to all of you for participating and look forward to your presence in our next webinar. The next webinar of Dr. Ragini happens to be tomorrow. And the next webinar that Jackson Pal is hosting is going to be this Sunday, which will be PAN Symposia on PCOS. Thank you very much and see you all.